All right. So again, welcome everyone. We're so glad that you've joined us today for what I call a very special Be Well Education session. So my name is Mariah Bruner. I'm the Employee Wellbeing Program Manager here at UCA. We've got a very special topic today, though, that really applies not only to employees, but all members of the UCA campus community. We've got our subject matter expert, Dr. Stephanie Rose, here to present our topic for the day on the opioid crisis in Arkansas, but also locally, and then really exciting talking about the new Naloxbox program that's kicking off here on campus. So I'll let Dr. Rose introduce herself a little bit more thoroughly here in just a moment. A few things before we really get going. We welcome questions along the way or at the end. Please use the chat box. We will keep checking that. Dr. Rose is a multitasker, and so she'll be checking that box, and I will too if she misses anything. So again, please don't be shy. We do welcome questions. This is really supposed to be a learning opportunity for everyone. And for Be Well participants, so these are employees here at UCA that are involved in our wellness program. If you'd like to get your points for today's session, I'll share information about how to get those points at the end, so stick around for that. And then lastly, just a disclaimer, we are recording this session. We will post it to Be Well's YouTube channel later this afternoon. And then, of course, I'll share that direct link to Dr. Rose, and she can share that out to any partners or stakeholders or colleagues that weren't able to join us live or that just want to spread the word. Again, we want to make this information widely available. So again, just recording, and that'll be available for you at any time. So without further ado, I'm going to hand it over to Dr. Rose. Thanks so much for being here.
Thank you. Thank you for having me and everyone who's joined. I just thank you for being here. That means so much. For our campus, for our students, for our community. This is just the beginning of a truly wonderful program. And for UCA to be the first to offer this in our state just is an honor. And the support that we've received for this is wonderful. Just to kind of kick things off, my name is Dr. Stephanie Rose. I'm an assistant professor, as well as the program director for UCA Addiction Studies Program, which is part of the health sciences. And we're gonna just kind of talk about our Naloxbox program that we have been able to provide on our campus. Okay, so, just a little introduction, and I know that this has been shared, you know, on the news and in the Echo, and you guys might have already heard about it, but for those who may not have, we are going to have 27 Naloxboxes available all over campus. Our first one was officially installed in the UCA ITC clinic. And we held a press conference and just kind of some education on why this was needed. And you could see in the picture here, we plan to install them near defibrillators when possible or first aid kits. To me, it's very much like, you know, a defibrillator or any other life-saving resource that we might have on campus. So all of the Naloxboxes, and you can see there, it's opioid rescue kit. They're going to be in every on-campus housing building in the common areas, and then in each of the Greek life houses. Our RCs and RAs will all be trained on how to use Narcan, as well as each Greek life group. And then we plan to start rolling out trainings to UCA staff and employees who are interested in receiving further education on this important rescue device. So this was done in collaboration with the Arkansas Collegiate Network. We've been very involved and very thankful for that partnership. The Arkansas Division of Aging, Adult, and Behavioral Health Services, Mid-South Prevention, and UCA. It was a wonderful year where everything came together. Everybody came together for this common goal. And, you know, the support has been truly wonderful that we've received at UCA. So each box includes 2 4-milligram doses of nasal Narcan, an instruction card on how to use it. It's very relatively easy to use. An instruction card, as well as a referral card to leave with a person who might want to seek further treatment if they have an addiction or are struggling and would just like further treatment. So I thought it would be important to kind of talk about how opioids work. They work by attaching to proteins in the brain, the spinal cord, the GI tract. These are known as your opioid receptors. And when opioids attach to those receptors, they block pain. And so, you know, they block the messages to the brain and the person feels little to no pain, which is great if we have surgeries or, you know, chronic pain issues where those are needed. However, we'll kind of talk about how this can become a further problem. And then we have some new types of opioids that are very dangerous. And we'll talk further about those. But opioids, they act on the brain regions that mediate pleasure. So that's why they're so addictive, because they induce a very euphoric feeling to form in the person who's using the opioid's body. You hear often about, you know, that there's a movie about opioid addiction called Chasing the Dragon. Many times, you know, people are never able to obtain that first euphoric feeling again, but yet if you build tolerance and your brain can actually stop producing dopamine because it becomes dependent on the opioid. You're going to build tolerance. It's just the nature of the drug. And so it leads to further issues. Opioids also reduce a user's heart rate because it causes widening of the blood vessels. And this starts to depress coughing and breathing reflexes, all of which contribute to an overdose. And I love graphics and visuals. So I had this pulled up. And I like that they actually have your address. And this may be something I was thinking about attaching to each of the rescue kits, because sometimes we don't know our exact address where we are. And so it may be helpful. But if you, no matter if you administer Narcan, always you want to call 911 as well, you know, delegate someone to do that. But things to look for, the person cannot be woken up or they're not moving, choking or coughing, gurgling, snoring sounds, almost like they're half asleep and can't wake up. Breathing can be slow or absent, dizziness and disorientation, cold, clammy skin. You want to feel the person, you know, just like touch maybe their arm or shoulder. Pupils are going to be extremely small, and definitely you will probably see some discoloration, like starting blue in the lips and fingernails because circulation has stopped. And you want to get the training to further gather information on the additional first aid techniques that you can use, such as providing rescue breaths, even after using naloxone if you have it. And I just want to take a moment and see if there are any questions thus far. Nope. Okay, let's proceed. So why was this a need? You know, I get that question often. So just this is straight from our DEA, some facts, and as well as some information that I obtained from people on campus. So The Arkansas State Crime Lab reports there were 493 drug overdose deaths in 2021. It's a lot of people. It was 281 of those deaths were caused by fentanyl, which is a type of opioid that we will cover more in depth as we progress. And 43 autopsies are still pending. In 2020, there were 329 drug overdose related deaths, with 148 caused by fentanyl. So we can see how fentanyl is a huge chunk of these overdoses. Not to say that opioids, prescription opioids, do not account for some of these, because they certainly do. But I definitely want to just hone in on the danger of fentanyl. In 2019, there were 263 drug overdoses related deaths, with 80 of them caused by fentanyl. And fentanyl is tricky, and it is spreading really fast because it is a synthetic opioid that is 50 to 100 times stronger than morphine. Pharmaceutical fentanyl was developed for pain management treatment of cancer patients. So it was made very strong in order to treat terminal illness and pain associated with diseases such as cancer. The problem is it's very cheap and easy to make. So we have a lot of basement labs, people making it. We see a lot of it coming from both Mexico and China. It's just so cheap to make. So we're seeing it laced in a lot of pills. We're seeing it laced in marijuana and other methods. There was a news report, I think it was in the last year, of someone had fentanyl folded up in a dollar bill and either dropped it or purposely did it. I think it was actually car fentanyl, and even the touch to the skin and getting it contact with it required this person to go to the emergency room. We've also had police officers searching vehicles and getting it on them and needing, in some cases, more than one dose of Narcan to help reverse that overdose. So most of the time, people who end up with fentanyl or carfentanil in their system, they had no clue that this is what they were ingesting. First responders recently administered Narcan to reverse an overdose on two separate occasions around campus. One was over by the AETN building, and one was actually at a business close to UCA. However, UCA's officers were the closest and were able to get there and save someone's life and reverse the overdose. In the United States, an estimated 18 million people have misused prescription drugs in the past year. It's most common among ages 18 to 25. And we'll talk about why some of those, why that age is so common. Any questions?
We did have one in the chat. If it's okay, I'll read that out to you. Sure. And that way it's captured on the recording as well. What are the side effects of Narcan if administered and it turns out that the person is not overdosing?
Okay, and I was going to cover that as we proceed, but this is just, you know, and I'm not trying to be funny, but it is kind of funny. The really worst case is going to be a wet nose. It's safe to use. They say use it even if you're not sure. If a person is unconscious and they're exhibiting some of those symptoms we went over, go ahead and administer it. There's no real dangerous side effects. Good question, very important question. Okay, so this slide, how much can cause an overdose? And I love good visuals here. So you can see the amount of heroin that would cause an overdose. And this is straight off the DEA's website. You could see how much fentanyl is needed. So just think if this is sprinkled on some marijuana, you know, people are not most likely going to see that or know. And then carfentanil, which is the more potent version of fentanyl, is also out there on the market. And just, you know, I think this picture says it all, as in terms of how potent this stuff is. So this is what I often hear, especially people who buy things off the black market, such as marijuana. That's probably the most common that I hear it. But I know my dealer. So, you know, the problem is the dealer generally is low on the totem pole. They often don't know if the product has been laced or where it originated from. You know, not saying that all of them have bad intentions, but a lot of times, you know, their goal is to make money, and that's important to think about. The average person cannot tell the difference between a real pill and a fake pill by looking at them. And I'm going to show you some differences in these pills, and just kind of to demonstrate how people are getting in trouble and not knowing what they're taking or even understanding what they're taking. But just another graphic on how the tablets break down. So, you know, you have the tablet matrix plus active substances and the blending. And so you see where it can be very easy to mask this stuff in what we call them press pills, is what we call them. And this, can you tell the difference? So we have a real Xanax bar, as most are called, versus a counterfeit. Real Adderall. And this Adderall is purchased by all age groups on the street a lot. And so very important to please note, they look very similar. It would be very difficult to tell the difference. A real oxycodone versus the counterfeits. So just really want to, you know, these are just a few examples, but these pills are made to look like the real thing, and people are buying them, taking them, and then we have an overdose because they don't know what they took or what they're getting. And the whole point is, it's cheaper to make than, and they can sell it for the same price as they would, you know, a real street drug. But it's been laced or cut with fentanyl to save on that profit. So let's kind of talk about how Narcan works. So it's a medication that reverses an overdose caused by an opioid drug, such as prescription pain medication, heroin, fentanyl, and so forth. So when administered during an overdose, naloxone blocks the effects of opioids on the brain and restores breathing within 2 to 8 minutes to prevent death. This is why sometimes rescue breaths are needed, and many of the kits have a protective shield that you can put down on someone's mouth to administer those rescue breaths. And then there's a needleless syringe applicator. The ones that we have in the Narcan kits are made for dual administration to both nasal passages, and you just simply squeeze it in. And then you want to repeat that dose. There's 2 4-milligram doses. So there are a lot of myths about naloxone, and I think it's really important that we address some of those. So, you know, in 2017, I was already like, we need to get this on campus and, you know, train people to use it, because we could just see, and as I shared with you guys, progressively over the years, this has become a steady problem. But a lot of what I heard was based around stigma. And that's just because people didn't understand, you know, the importance of this medication and you know, how it's just another way for all of us to be empowered to save lives, that students' lives, your fellow employees' lives, visitors on campus. I mean, this really impacts everybody. So one of the number one myths that I hear is that it's going to encourage substance users to take more drugs. The research has shown that naloxone does not lead to more drug use or risk. In fact, some studies have shown that naloxone results in a decreased use of opioids. Naloxone also causes opioid withdrawal symptoms, which is an effective abuse deterrent. So often when people get to that point, you know, it's scary, and a lot of people actually seek treatment. And thank goodness we're able to provide a second chance for folks, you know. So I really encourage everybody just to look at it that way. We are saving people's lives and giving them second chances. And that's what's important. So naloxone, the second myth is naloxone prevents substance users from seeking treatment. There's absolutely no evidence to support this. And a lot of times, as I said, it's a catalyst for people who want to, or it's kind of like that motivating factor. This was a wake-up call. I need help. Naloxone makes people violent. It's one of the most common side effects of naloxone administration in patients is confusion and disorientation. It is rare for someone to wake up from an overdose and become combative. This is especially rare if naloxone is administered by someone they know and they trust. So when they come to and they see your face, or if you can talk to them to calm them, but it's scary. You know, they may wake up and not realize, like, what the heck just happened to me. Myth four, only doctors can prescribe naloxone. Every state is different. So you can actually go to certain places, and my hope is that UCA will be one of those places soon, fingers crossed on some grant funds for that, to be able to hand out naloxone kits to those who would like to carry one. I carry one in my vehicle, my husband carries one, you know, I have my teenager carry one, because you never know when, you know, an overdose could occur. Naloxone is taking too much of the public's funds and attention. Every medical visit to the ER is going to be costly. Narcan actually is a very affordable way to save someone's life. So, you know, we need to kind of think about, you know, prevention and how that actually helps to save money. You know, and I hate to even talk about money when it comes to saving someone's lives, but I do know that that is an important aspect that especially some stakeholders may be interested in hearing. First responders administer naloxone to the same people over and over again. There is no research that has supported this, especially with the majority of overdose patients. Really do not have repeated overdose events. Even so, public health officials, and I know I feel this way and many others I work with, who cares? Because every life is important. And if we can save a life, how wonderful is that? And so I just encourage everyone to focus on that. But it is important to kind of work on debunking these myths so that we can start to decrease the stigma that surrounds this issue. So some local efforts, we actually have a central Arkansas harm reduction project, and they give out Narcan kits. And so as of, you know, they haven't been around a super long time, they're fairly new, but already they have counted 117 of their naloxone kits had been used and saved lives. That is amazing just for one agency. That's their report. It's also important that everyone be aware, you know, you employees at the university, students, many times are not aware of this wonderful law that we have in Arkansas, the Joshua Ashley Pauley Act. And I took the bill and the law straight from the words, straight from the bill, I apologize. So a person shall not be arrested, charged, or prosecuted for possession of a controlled substance in violation of law number if the evidence of the arrest, charge, or prosecution of the possession of a controlled substance in violation resulted solely from seeking medical assistance if, and you can look here. So if even if you are partaking, this bill assists to protect you. And this is very important. I had a cousin at 21 years old who was using, just they had done this several times, smoking marijuana from a bong, and they had extracted some fentanyl from a patch and mixed it in the marijuana. Super dangerous because you don't know what parts of the marijuana have more. You know, it's not like they microdosed it or anything. But for whatever reason, he overdosed and just immediately stopped breathing. Well, the group of people that he was with were afraid to call for help and tried all these other splashing cold water on his face and, you know, all these different things. And by the time they called, out of fear for their own safety, there was just no bringing him back. And this was, you know, this was like 10 plus years ago. And so just if only Narcan could have been available, you know, who knows what could have happened, but this isn't a new problem. It's just gaining attention because fentanyl is becoming more and more prevalent in our state. So any questions thus far?
Lots of great discussion in the chat box. We also just had a question come in, a clarifying question. Are Narcan and Naloxone the same thing? Are those interchangeable terms? Yeah, good question.
Branding, that's really all it is. So what can you do to help? Educate. We've got to start breaking down some of these stigmas. And so, you know, you have this education now. So don't be afraid to share it with people, make it a discussion. You know, the more we talk about it, the less stigmatized I hope it will be. And, you know, letting people know, hey, there are a lot of pills on the street that are made and mixed with fentanyl. Marijuana that you purchase off the street could very well be mixed with fentanyl. So a lot of you don't know unless you know this information isn't always readily available. So very important to remain educated and just kind of keep up with the different things that are going on. We actually have a UCA Addiction Studies Facebook page. I encourage everybody who might want to just kind of stay up to date on new news and different events that are happening. You know, I always try to post articles on there about this topic, as well as other addiction related topics. Advocate for more Narcan kits. Advocate for, how can you support, places who are trying to give these out to people to save lives. Participate, you know, get involved. I'll be offering, once we get through our first phase of training the folks in housing, my goal is to open the training on how to use Narcan and the other it's a little bit more in depth with what you can receive from the training. So participate, please come to those. You know, I'll be offering several ones for free because like I said, you never know when a coworker, a student, a visitor on campus, it could happen anytime. And so knowing where the different locations are is gonna be very important. So yes, familiarize yourself. Where is my nearest Narcan kit? Support and refer to on-campus services. So I know UCA has a wonderful EAP system, and I believe Mariah is going to share more about that. Students have on-campus services through the UCA Health Center. And we also have, Addiction Studies has a clinic through the ITC in which we see folks. So there's a lot of support out there, you know, so don't be afraid to refer, to participate yourself. We also offer a smart recovery group that you can attend. You don't even have to have your real name. You can turn your camera off every Tuesday at noon, and it is evidence-based. It uses motivational interviewing as well as CBT for all addictions. Participate in those upcoming trainings. Find out how you can have a personal Narcan kit to carry, because you never know when an overdose can occur. So like I said, I know a lot of people carry first aid kits in their car, CPR kits. Well, this could be another great thing to keep with you at all times. And always want to leave people with resources. So if you want to learn more about the Arkansas Collegiate Network, UCA is very involved, and the ACN really supports us. We will be having our kickoff for Save Our Students Week starting October 24th. And UCA always has a presence at the Capitol. Just to continue that advocacy and education for students and the public. The DEA fact sheets on fentanyl has really great graphics and really straight to the point information. This is the law codes about the Joshua Ashley Pauley Act. Mid-South UA Litterox Center for Prevention and Training, they offer so many free conferences and webinars. If you are interested, and they also assisted with getting us those Naloxboxes. Narcansaw's app, you can download this or visit the website. I'd highly recommend downloading the app. Constant new updates and information from our state on what you can do as far as prevention efforts. And then a really cool resource I came across at a national conference called CADCA is the You Think You Know project out of Connecticut. And it just really has a lot of great information on Narcan, press pills, you name it. And it's just a great blueprint if you're looking for resources on, you know, what can I do and how can I get this going? So that leaves me with my last slide. This is my information. If you would like to contact me, please do. I'm, you know, also if you'd ever like to partner with Addiction Studies on a prevention activity, we have a wonderful event coming up in partnership with the nursing program to do an alcohol poisoning simulation that we hope to record and share. So anyway, any questions that I can answer?
We did have a couple more come up in the chat. Let me get back to those. And real quick, if anybody needs to hop off the call, I know everybody's got a busy day ahead. I did post in the chat our certificate of attendance for today. You can just click on that link and download the PDF, and you should load that up to your account on MyHealthCheck360 to get your 5 points. I will also flash the slide here at the end, but if anybody needs to hop off, it's there for you. Okay, going back to the top here. I got a very specific question, direct message, but I will kind of reframe it. It said, you know, are there grants available to get them deployed into other areas on campus or other sort of first responder types?
Yes. So our UCA police officers have all been trained and they carry kits. So that is one, you know, one way to get this. Hospitals, our local hospitals, are all being trained on Narcan, and Kimberly Ashley Polly is actually pretty involved in that as well. And they're working to, if someone comes in for an overdose, they're working to send them out with Narcan kits, personal Narcan kits. Yes, there are grants available. A lot of what we get now is through the Criminal Justice Institute. But I am planning to request as many personal Narcan kits to give out, not just to the community, but to UCA employees and staff and students who are interested. So you come to the training. My hope is if we get this grant, you leave with a kit. But either way, when I get those in my hands, I want to get those out to the people who want one and want to use one. So that is in the works and part of our phase through this process.
Okay, that covers a few of the questions we got in the chat, people wanting to get their hands on one of these Narcan kits.
That is in the works.
Okay, yep. Got it. When all the kits have been installed on campus, will there be a centralized list of where all of those kits will be located? Can you speak to that?
Yes. So they will all be located in housing. So any housing on or off campus that's affiliated with UCA in the common areas. And if they have an AED, they're going to be next to that. In the student center, we're going to put it in the common area. And then in all the Greek life houses, that's where all the Naloxboxes will go. I'm trying to think the best way. Maybe I can email Mariah, or we can email UCA Inform perhaps and share that.
Yes, I'd be happy to post that on our website as like a permanent part of our resources guide too. That would be
perfect.
Easy to share. Yes, that's
there. We go.
Question. Yeah. Will you email campus to let us know about trainings?
Yes.
Yep.
Okay. And honestly, I would probably contact Mariah about that too. If folks want to attend, she can send an email blast and we will advertise in different ways. Absolutely. Yeah, because I want you guys to show up and get this. So
that's right. Yes, we will. We will partner to get that information out to campus for sure. Millie Goins noted that Addiction Studies is going to be sharing information at the Student Wellness Fair on September 27th from 10 to 2 in the Hyper Gym. So that was a great reminder. Thank you, Millie, for doing that.
Yes, actually, my two addiction studies interns will be over there, and they're going to bring a mock kit, and they can demonstrate how to use it, and they'll have a video playing on a loop to show how it's implemented and used as part of that.
I love that. Someone asked if there were additional like educational pamphlets or other resources that they could use to educate. They said clients on Narcan. I'm not sure. I'm sorry. I don't know where you work. I mean, you might be in the counseling center, but that's just a guess. I'm not sure.
That's why I shared. I would say that Narcansaw app is really, really good. It's, you know, really comprehensive. Mid-South prevention and training, those folks, that's all they do is, you know, education. We are also working in partnerships with DABS and Mid-South on a series of children's books, as well as high school and college age books on, you know, different substances. So we have one on opioids, we have one on vaping, But this next series is on it's in relation to the Me Over Meth campaign. And so they're very interactive. They have QR codes that take you to websites that are very informative, teach coping skills and things like that. So please be watching for those. And if you want some of those to give out, let's get them in your hands to give out.
Agree. I can't cover every, there's lots of great discussion in the chat. So I'll pull the transcript, Dr. Rosen, and I'll send that to you so you can see everything that everybody's talking about.
I'm so happy that there's a lot of good discussion.
It has been really good. I'll share one final thing and then we can wrap up. Someone suggested that we list the locations of all the kits on the UCA, the A to Z directory. I think that's a great idea. And then just, file it under Narcan and Narcan. I've got a note on that too. I think that's a great suggestion. Thank you.
Absolutely. Thank you for sharing.
Okay. I don't see any other, I think we addressed all the questions. Again, I'll pull this chat transcript and share that with Dr. Rose so she can see everything you all discussed and share. There's some peer-to-peer sharing, which was great too. Okay. Let me share real quick. I'm going to share our certificate of attendance. If anybody wants to capture it this way, I did post the PDF in the chat that you can download. But some folks, if you have a smartphone and you just want to take a quick snapshot or picture of this and load it up that way using the mobile app, I've just got it up there for you. So I'll just leave that up there for just a few moments. But Dr. Rose, thank you so much for sharing all this awesome information. Thank you and all your partners for all the work you've done to bring this program to campus. We know it will save lives, and we look forward to more trainings and getting more Narcan kits distributed across campus. We're going to make it happen. So thank you so much.
Yes, more training, more education coming down the pike.
That's right.
Thank you, everyone, for making time in your day to attend. I really appreciate it.
Thanks, everyone. Have a great afternoon.
Bye. Take good care.